I invite you to stand and join with us as we worship the Lord together. Revive us again. The Lion and the Lamb. Join with us. He's coming in the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. Chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's rolling with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. Sin of the world, his blood breaks the chain. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain. Of the world, his blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
Who can stop the Lord?
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow for the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow.
Welcome, Miss Mary Smith.
Die. seminary, we join together and sing Jesus, Friend of Sinners.
Jesus, Friend of Sinners, we have strayed so far away. We've cut down people in your name, but the sword was never ours to swing. Jesus, Friend of Sinners, the truth's become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around, never looking up, I'm so double-minded. A plank-eyed saint with dirty hands and a heart divided.
Oh, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Must reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours.
Jesus, Friend of Sinners, the one who's writing in the sand made the righteous turn away and the stones fall from their hands. Help us to remember we are all the least of these. Let the memory of your mercy bring your people to their knees. Nobody knows what we're for, only what we're against when we judge the wounded. Put down our signs, crossed over the lines, and love like you did.
Oh, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open. Friend of Sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. You love every lost cause, you reach for the outcast, for the leper and the lame. You're the reasons that you came. When I was the lost cause, and I was the outcast, but you died for sinners just like me.
Those things that God has done, bringing us to his mercy, He will do again.
My confidence, you never fail.
still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. You never fail me yet. And I never will forget. You've never failed me yet. And I never will forget.
God, you've been merciful to us. God bless you. Thank you.
Amen. God has been merciful to us. Amen. Let's talk about revival. Now, revival occurs when something that was once alive is been brought back to life. And so you can't revive something that's never been given life the first time, right? That's why there's a difference between revival and evangelism. You see, evangelism is when you share the gospel with a person who's lost, who's spiritually dead, has never been made alive in Christ. And then revival is what happens when someone is spiritually sluggish and has been in a slumber, if you will, a spiritual slumber, and needs to be awakened from that and brought back to vitality. So revival is simply this: God's wake-up call. Say that with me. God's wake-up call. That's revival. And revival is an important thing. Revival is when God brings His people back to repentance, His backsliding people. Now, let's talk about what the Christian life looks like. I always think about it as the side of a mountain. A lot of people think that they live like this as a Christian, kind of on flat, level ground. Anybody ever been out to West Texas? I mean, that thing is flat. You go out to Amarillo, you can see 30 miles away as you're driving down the interstate. You say, I'm almost there. Well, it's just so flat, and there's not a thing out there. I mean, it's just flat. And you drive and drive and drive. You never get to those lights, it seems like. Well, in the same way in the Christian life, life is not flat in the Christian life. You are either moving up the mountain, you are gaining ground, you are growing closer to the Lord, or you are sliding down. You are sliding back. We call that backslidden, right? Backsliders. So that's the way the Christian life is working. Spiritual progress comes, though, when we see ourselves in the same way God sees us. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13 for just a second. This isn't our focus passage, but I want you to see something very important here. And it says here, neither is there any creature that is not manifest, listen, in His sight. Say that with me. In His sight. But all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of Him with whom we have to do. See, God knows everything and everybody. Isn't that right? But there are those who don't know God. Everybody doesn't know God, and you need to know God. So as we come to our text in the Old Testament book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 14, go ahead and turn there with me this morning. We are going to see the most famous verse in the Bible about revival. Everybody say revival. And so it is. This verse was given to King Solomon at the dedication of the temple. And in verse 13, the verse just before the 14th verse, we see that the Lord is telling them that there is some problem going on. And because of their disobedience and because they wouldn't listen to God's word, they wouldn't listen to God's command, awful things are going to happen in the land. So that's the bad news. But there's good news when you come to verse 14, because he says, here's how to avoid that. Here's how to change all of that. It's time for God's judgment to be reversed. It's time for revival to come, and that's what he talks about in chapter 7, verse 14. So friends, we stand in desperate need of a revival. Do you believe that? I believe it with all my heart. So let's stand in reverence to God's word and ask Him to show us three secrets of God for revival for us today. I believe this verse truly was written for such a time as the day we live in 2021. Listen to this. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then, first part of the verse, if, second part of the verse, then will I hear from heaven, will forgive their sins, and will what? Heal their land. Oh, Father, I thank you for the precious word of God. Oh, Father, how we need to know the secrets to revival. How we want to be revived. How we want to be awakened from spiritual slumber in our lives, Lord, even if we are believers. And I pray for those who've never been awakened in the first place, Lord. They're dead in trespasses and sins spiritually, but they long to be made alive in Christ. May this day be a wonderful birthday for them as they come to Christ. And for those who are already believers, Lord, would you awaken us up to what you've got as you teach us the secrets of revival in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Well, let's get right into it. God's first secret for revival is the right people. You say, the right people? Wait a minute now. Are you talking about some sort of exclusive club where these folks are in and these folks are out? I mean, is that what you're trying to get at, preacher? No, that's not what I'm trying to get to. I think about 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. And when I look at this verse, I'm reminded that God was not writing to a Democrat or a Republican. This is not about politics. This is about your spiritual life. I'm also reminded that he was very exclusive. He said, if my people who are called by my name. Now that is exclusive. This wasn't written to a Hindu. I love Hindus, but that's not who it's written to. God did not write this to a Muslim. I love Muslims, but God didn't write this to a Muslim. God didn't write this to a Buddhist. God didn't write it to anyone who's not trusted in Him. He wrote verse 14 for us. This promise applies today in 2021 to those who have trusted the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive them of their sins, come into their lives, and save their souls. To be called by the name of the Lord. He says, if my people who are called by my name, if those people, to be called by the name of the Lord means that you have called upon the name of the Lord and asked Him to save you. Amen? Look with me at Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Short verse, but such a powerful, such an important verse. If you ever heard of the Roman road to salvation, this is a key verse in that passage. It says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So important that is. So the right people, the first secret to revival is the right people. The right people are God's people. And you say, well, Brother Paul, what am I supposed to do if I'm not the right people? What am I supposed to do if I'm not God's people? Friend, if you're not, I want you to be, and God wants you to be. So what you need to do today is come to Him, ask Him to forgive you, ask Him to save you, and become one of God's people this morning. I can promise you that there will be so many excited folks for that change in your life. Now, secondly, I want you to see. I know you think, wow, all through the first point? Wow, this thing will be done in 10 minutes, won't it? No, not really. But at any rate, secondly, I want you to notice in the middle of this verse, God's second secret to revival is the right conditions. Say conditions. Now, He gives us some things that if we'll do them, it's unconditionally true that when these conditions are met, that He will change the conditions for you and bring revival. God's second secret to revival is the right conditions. Before revival comes, God's people must meet four conditions, and they're found right here in the middle of this verse. Notice it again. Shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. That's four things. So the first condition is humility. Humble yourselves is a statement of position. The word humility comes from the root word humus or humus. And how many of you like to plant flowers and shrubs and those kind of things? My very first pastorate in 1987 was in a small country church, New Union Baptist Church out from Eastman, Georgia, and half of that church was a farming community. And so it was wonderful. So my very first assignment on the Sunday before I became their pastor was they had a work day at the church to plant shrubs around the church. Well, if you want to learn how to do something, give it to a farmer and listen and watch them closely. Brother Bo, you know a few of those farmers that were out there that particular day. And those guys got there at 7 o'clock in the morning. You know, that half their day was over by 7 o'clock as a farmer. So they got out there, and we mixed up stuff called black cow. We mixed up some humus, and we also mixed in some soil. And we did all these things just right, and we put those things in the ground. Well, my mama used to plant flowers, so I never really paid all that much attention to it. I just thought you stuck stuff in the ground. It just grew. That's just the way it worked. Not the New Union way. No, sir. We did it right. We went back years and years and years later, and that church actually burned to the ground. But I want you to know that shrubbery was massive. That stuff worked because it had the right soil ingredients. It had the right nourishment in the soil. Friends, humility is that from that humus, which means soil or dirt, which means to get down to the ground, which means to humble yourself. So that's where the term humility comes from, and that's what it's all about. We are to meet God on our knees, if you will. And you say, well, Brother Paul, I've got bad knees. I can't get down on my knees. Or if I get down on my knees, I may not be able to get back up. Well, if that's the case, that's all right. You can sit down or you can spiritually humble yourselves even if you can't physically do it. Amen? So God expects us to do that. A humble person sees himself as he truly is and sees God as he truly is. The majestic, gracious, omnipotent, sovereign God. If you go over to Philippians chapter 2, you'll find that Jesus, the Bible says, who was equal with God, made himself of no reputation. He humbled himself even to the death of the cross. That's what Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8 says. But I want you to go over to verses 9 through 11 in Philippians chapter 2 and notice these words. Wherefore God hath also highly exalted him. Him who? Jesus. And given him a name which is above every name. An unmatched position, friends. That at the name of Jesus, every knee. How many knees? Now is that every Baptist knee? Is it every Protestant knee? Is it every Christian knee? No. This is atheists, agnostics, Buddhists, Hindus. Muslims, you name it, wherever you are on the spectrum, anywhere on the face of the earth, whether you believe, whether you don't believe, one day every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess what? That Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So one day everybody will be humbled, no matter how haughty they are in this life, no matter how proud or egotistical or narcissistic they are now, one day the good news is every knee shall bow. The problem is for a lot of those people who've chosen not to believe in him, it's going to be a horrible day. They're going to be forced to admit and agree that what we know to be true is true, and they're going to miss out on the blessing of that. But they're still going to have to proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. God's people must remember who is Lord. Humility reminds me, God's God and I'm not. Say that with me. God's God and I'm not. We are to admit humbly our weakness and reach out for his power. Humbly reaching out for his power. We are basically saying in so many words in this idea, I can't, but you can, O God. Say that with me. I can't, but you can, O God. Nowhere is there a better picture of this, I believe, than in the book of Joshua. So go over to the Old Testament book of Joshua real quick with me, please. Chapter 5, verses 13 through 15. And watch what happens in this passage. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes, looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with the sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, Art thou for us or for our adversary? In other words, whose side are you on? Verse 14. And he said, Nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord am I come now. In other words, I've come to take over. Then it says, and Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship. Would you say he humbled himself there? I sure would. And said unto him, What saith my Lord unto his servant? I have humbled myself, Lord. I am a servant in your hands. Verse 15, don't miss this. And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, Loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is what? Holy. And Joshua did so. Joshua, in so many words, said, I can't, but you can, O God. He's told to remove his shoe. That's an ancient way of symbolically saying, God, you're in charge, and I am not. I am humbling myself. In 1 Peter, in the New Testament, chapter 5, verse 5, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5, the Bible puts it this way. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with what, church? Humility. For God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to whom? The humble. That's exactly right. When we start feeling too puffed up about ourselves, we need to remember the words of 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7, which says, what do you have that you did not receive? I want you to think about that for a second. What do I have possession of that I did not receive? And you know what the answer to that is? Nothing. Everything I have received. I didn't invent it. I didn't create it out of nothing. I've received it. Now, I want to give kudos right now to anyone who's worked and scratched and saved. And just through the sweat equity or perspiration or whatever, you know, sweat is what horses do, perspiration is what people do. So regardless of how you got there, I want to give you kudos if you've made it to the top. But when you get to the top, I want you to look around and remember this, that the strength to do the tasks that you've done, the intelligence to put together the plan, the skill to get everything and bringing it all together, and the courage to make it happen came not from you, it came from God. Now, whether you use that for God's glory or not may be a different story, but I'm here to tell you the source of all that was God, because we are a creation of God. It comes, so we just need to humbly admit that's important. So the first part of this, the first condition is humility. The second condition is found right here in the middle of that verse again. He says, shall humble themselves and do what, church? Pray. Tonight, 6 p.m., we're going to have a concert of prayer right here in this room. I hope many of you will come and be a part of it with us. We haven't done anything ever like this as a church, and so I'm looking forward to it, and I'm excited about what God's going to do. Dr. Philip Brooks, preacher from long, long ago, said this, if man is man, which he is, and God is God, which he is, to live without prayer is not merely an awful thing, it's an infinitely foolish thing. And how true that is. Every day we need to remember the words of John's Gospel, chapter 15, verse 5, when Jesus said, without me, you can do how much? Nothing. Not a thing in this world. That's right. I love the words also of the psalmist in Psalm 66, verse 18. Don't miss this. Psalm 66, 18 says, if I regard iniquity, that sin, folks, in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Now, you say, wait a minute. If I have sin in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. If I hold to that sin, if I don't want to get rid of that sin, if I just think I'm justified in my sin, God won't hear me. You know what that implies? That God is listening. And God is listening because our job is to pray. That's right. God has a job for us to do, and it is to pray. And I hope you are a person of prayer. Listen, it's hard to get right with God if you're not spending time with God in prayer. Did you know that the statistics tell us that the average Christian in America today of any age spends less than 10 minutes in prayer and Bible study? Less than 10 minutes a day in prayer and Bible study. So I ask you this question. I really want you to think about it hard. How can I be right with God if I'm not in conversation with God? I'm going to say that again, and I want you to say it with me. How can I be right with God if I'm not in conversation with God? So humility is the first condition. Prayer is the second condition. Now look back here in verse 14 again, and he says, humble themselves and pray. Here's the third condition coming at you. And seek my face. Who's speaking here? God is speaking. He's saying, seek the face of God. Now, so that's the third condition. Notice it doesn't say, seek my hand. You know, a lot of people want the hand of God in their life, don't they? They want the hand of God. They want a hand out from God. They want God to be the gimme God. They want God to give me all the freebies. You know, we want the free stuff. And so, Lord, give me the free stuff. God, just pour it on me. Just bless me, bless me, bless me. But they're not so interested in the face of God. Rather, we are to seek the face of God. You see, the hand of God has to do with what He can do for you. The face of God is who He is to you. He is saying, seek the face of God. Remember who God is supposed to be to you. Peter Lord said it this way. If we only seek God for what He can do for us, rather than seeking Him for Him, we are spiritual, listen, idolaters. Boy, that's convicting. To seek His face means to seek His favor. I want to be in a good place with God. Do you want to be in a good place with God? The phrase, seek my face, has to do with the direction of my life. Join me over in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5, verse 6. This is part of what's called the Beatitudes. And Jesus Himself said these words in Matthew 5, 6. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after what? Righteousness, for they shall be what? Filled. That's God's promise. So He wants you to do that. One of the problems with the church today is that we have so many pursuits in our lives, we don't have anything that's in first place or anyone that's in first place. In fact, you know, a lot of people say, what's first place in your life? What's most important priority in your life? A lot of folks say, well, you know, I kind of think it's a tie. There are really three or four things. No, if that's your answer, that's a really bad answer. What does the Bible say in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Amen? That's what God wants us to do. So we need to seek God's face. He needs to be the priority. You want to experience revival? You want to find a secret to revival? Make sure that you're humbling yourself, you're praying, and you're seeking God's face. We need to fall in love with God once again to the point that He becomes the focus and the driving force of everything we're doing, everything we are, and everything that we're about. Let's determine that we will obey the commandment. Well, you know, the Ten Commandments over in Exodus chapter 20. When you get to Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, you know what the commandment says there? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And so there it is. You're seeking God's face. What you're hungry for determines what you seek. He tells us to seek God's face. So that brings us to the fourth condition. So let's go back to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. After I humble myself, after I pray, after I seek His face, then I need to do what? Turn from their wicked ways. I need to turn from my wicked ways. Turn from my evil ways. And that shows, when I turn from my evil ways, that means I am no longer walking away from God. I am now walking toward God. That's the focus I need to have, is walking toward God. Now, the theological word that goes along with turning from our wicked ways is the word repentance. Everybody say repentance. Repentance is a strong word. It means to turn around. It means admitting that I'm going the wrong direction. Don't you love that picture up there? That's a neat picture. That's kind of confusing looking, but you are literally making a U-turn and going a different way. So repentance means to do what we used to talk about years ago. I can remember even as a kid, the preachers talking in this way. They say, you need to get right with God. Everybody say that. Get right with God. When you repent, you get right with God. Now, if you're getting right with God, that means there's something that's wrong in your relationship with God that requires you to get right with Him. Isn't that right? That's exactly right. So repentance is a spiritual about face. Those of you who've been in the military, when they say about face, what do? You turn. Boy, you get good at that pivot, don't you? You go, you just do it like a master there. So there you are. So God wants His people to do three things. First of all, examine our lives. Secondly, identify anything that does not please God or goes against His word. And thirdly, eliminate those things from our lives. So examine, identify, and eliminate. That's what God wants us to do. So as we humble ourselves, as we pray, as we seek God's face, as we turn from our wicked ways, our sin will become increasingly clear. Now some folks say, well, Pastor, let me just sum it up. Here's what I'm going to do. Based on what you said, I realize it is time for me to turn over a new leaf. How many of you ever heard that? Turn over a new leaf? Well, you know, a lot of leaves are falling right now. And I wouldn't give you 10 cents for a leaf. I actually wish I'd never seen any leaves. They're out there. I got a bunch of them in my yard. If you got a shortage of them, you can come have all of mine. They'll be fine. You just pick them up one by one. It'll be great for you. But at any rate, you don't need to turn over a new leaf. You see, that's not what this is about. These four conditions form a kind of progression. What kind of progression, preacher? Very simply this. Humility leads to prayer. Prayer leads to the next thing, which is seeking God's face. And seeking God's face leads to turning from the ways you were doing it to do it God's way. So all these things work together. That brings us to the third secret. God's third secret to revival is very simply the right results. Look at the last part of verse 14 here. After he says, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways. After we get past the if part, then comes the then part. You meet the first condition, now you'll get the right result. The right result after the word then comes in here in three things that God says He will do. Three things. When we're so dissatisfied with the status quo that we cry out for God's help, the answer is going to come. Not a question of if, it's just when it's going to come, how it's going to come, and things will begin to change. What's going to happen? He will hear, He will forgive, and He will heal. Say that with me. He will hear, He will forgive, and He will heal. That's God's promise. Now, the idea is very simply this. If you'll honor God, God will honor you. Say that with me. If you will honor God, God will honor you. If we open our hearts, He'll open up the heavens. Praise God. If He hasn't opened up the heavens for you, ask yourself why not. If He hasn't opened the heavens to you, there's something missing. Friends, the United States of America has turned away from God. If you haven't noticed that, it's time to wake up. It's time to take the blinders off. It's time to pull the earplugs out of your ears. It's time to look, because we are in a mess. And is it possible that we can ever find our way back to God? Why, absolutely it is. How can we do that? Do this. What I just said in verse 14. That's what we've got to do. The problem is that we have too many people that believe that the answer to all of our problems is found in the White House. The answer to all of our problems is found in the next congressman or senator that we elect. They think that the answer to all of our problems is found out with the balance of power on the U.S. Supreme Court. Hey, friends, you know, I'm thankful for leadership, but I am also very aware that if we think any person, any one single person on this earth, regardless of who they are and what their title and what their power position is, can solve our problems, we have figured out the wrong thing. Our greatest need is not political. Our greatest need is spiritual. And until we get to that conclusion, we will not see a turnaround. We need another great awakening in this land, absolutely, without any question. I believe, and you may think I'm crazy, but that's okay. I think I'm crazy sometimes too, but this is the reality. I believe we're living in the last days before the Lord comes back. I just really do. If you go over to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, you'll see that the things that God said 2,000 years ago that were going to happen are happening. It's not stuff that is kind of starting to peek out a little bit. Man, we are in the middle of it. It is on fire and on steroids. It's so bad. So if Jesus is coming again, should that make a difference in how we live? Should it make a difference as to whether we're revived or not? Absolutely. Jesus asks a question in Luke chapter 18, verse 8. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, here's the question. Will he find faith on the earth? Say that with me. Will he find faith on the earth? In the last days, there's going to be a huge turning away from the Lord. We see that. It's going on right now. It's in full bloom. And we call it an apostasy. We call it a falling away. This is all spoken of in Matthew chapter 24, Mark chapter 13, Luke chapter 21, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. It's found throughout the New Testament in various places. This is not a new phenomenon. He's been telling us it was going to happen. So we are rushing headlong toward the return of Jesus Christ, who's going to call time one day, say, that's enough. I'm coming to get my children and take them home. And so that's going to be a great day for all the believers. But I believe that we should look around, and those who are claiming to be the false Christs or the false Messiahs, those who are spiritual counterfeits, those Christians who are compromising their faith, and those spiritual leaders who are misleading God's people, all these things are signs that this is going to happen. And it's going on today. As the foundations of society are crumbling around us, we will see this happening more and more, which only magnifies the need for, what's that R word? Revival. So here it is. Where does revival begin? Well, Brother Paul, the revival needs to begin with our nation. That's false. What? Of course it does. Well, the revival needs to begin with the church, Pastor. That's false too. The revival begins with me and you. That's where the revival. You know, we have a great eye for identifying sins in other people, don't we? We have a great eye for identifying sins in everywhere but right here. We need to draw the circle around it and start. The need for revival starts right here, right now. The call of Christ, listen, the call of Christ is always personal. That's you and God, just the two of you. So listen carefully. When you look at yourself in the mirror and you say, I need revival, then you get it. That's when revival starts. So may we be able to come to the end of our lives as the late, great William Whiting Borden, who wrote this, no reserves, no retreats, no regrets. If you're revived, you'll be able to say that. The key word in this verse, let's go back one more time to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. The key word, you know what the key word in the whole verse is? It's a two-letter word, and it's the first word in the verse. If is the biggest two-letter word in the English language, not because of how big it is on the screen, but because of this, the destiny of persons, families, nations, everything hinges on that one little word. If we're not willing to do what God desires for us to do and live the way God desires for us to live, if we're not, we're in a mess. Revival and spiritual awakening is found in the difference between only if and if only. What's the difference between only if and if only? Well, you say it's the way the words are arranged. No, it's more than that. Only if we will do what verse 14 says in 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Only if we do that will we experience revival. But we don't want to come to Judgment Day and say, if only I would have done that. If only I would have done what Christ. If only I would have turned from sin and self, I could have been saved before it was eternally too late. If only I would have done that, I could have had more joy in my Christian life. If only I would have listened to Jesus. I don't want to come to the end of my life and say, if only, do you? I want to be reminded that I did the only ifs. Those are the steps that it's going to take to get right with God. So the question is real simple. Are you willing to do what it takes? Would you ask God to forgive you and save you if you're not saved already? Would you believe the gospel? Would you believe that Christ died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sins because he loves you and he has a plan and a purpose for your life? God wants great things for you. That's good news. But for those of you who are believers, would you ask God to revive your heart, to reconnect you with humility and prayer and truly seeking God's face, not his hand, and then turning from any wicked way that's in it, in you? Those are the important things. And if we'll do that, hey, you'll experience revival. And you won't have to wait for somebody. You won't have to wait for the president or the Congress or the Supreme Court justices to do it. You won't have to wait for the church leaders in any church to do it, because you can experience revival. And by the way, it's a lot more contagious coming from you than it is from them anyway. Let's stand, let's pray, and let's respond. Oh Father, we are a people in need, in desperate need of a spiritual awakening. We need revival, oh God. Lord, revival is not always about a series of meetings with an evangelist present. It's an attitude of our hearts whereby your people humble themselves, pray, seek your face, and turn from their wicked ways. Lord, we love the promises that you will hear us, that you'll forgive us, that you'll heal us. Oh God, how we need that. Until we realize, oh Lord, that we're a broken people, how can we be made whole? So thank you, Lord, you've shown us what it takes. I pray that right now your Holy Spirit will move across our congregation. There'll be people who will respond, who will come and kneel at this altar, who will come and sit on this first row, who will just call out to you, oh God, and ask you to revive them again. They know they're Christians, but they need that spiritual awakening. God, for that one who's not saved, I pray that they'll come and they'll say, I want Jesus. Lord, it's all in your hands. We can't work it up. We're trusting you for it in Jesus' name.